I'm here with JD Lasica, author of Biohack, at the book launch party. And I thought it would be interesting to talk with you about what inspired you to write Biohack and kind of what made you want to explore genetics as kind of a techno-thriller topic.
Yes, and it is a techno-thriller with traces of science fiction in it. I've been writing about high-tech and technology for a long time as a technology correspondent, columnist for various publications. And so now I've gone over to the dark side and started with some high-tech fiction. And I looked around at the landscape and I thought that nobody's really writing about biotechnology and some of the things that can come out of this and how some of this really wild new genetic breakthroughs like CRISPR and things like that, it's no longer science fiction, it's science. It's like here today, and it sort of depends on what people want to do with it. So I wrote it in the context of a high-tech thriller that pits this heroine, Caden, against a guy who is the CEO of Birthrights Unlimited. He's trying to usher in the age of the new enhanced family. So this is coming to an IVF clinic near you in the next 10 years. It's set a little bit in the future to make it completely realistic, but basically you're going to be able to decide not just like the sex or gender of your baby, but also any kind of genetic enhancements you might want. Everything from the color of their pigment in their skin to their eye color to things like that. So I went a little bit crazy and decided to take it to its logical extension. So what if people wanted to clone like their favorite Hollywood movie celebrities and stars, right? You know, it's not that hard to get little traces of their DNA. What's really remarkable is people don't realize, so we've got like these, we consist of, it's like 20 trillion cells. And each of those 20 trillion cells contains your entire genetic profile. I think most people think, oh, well, you've got ear cells or tongue cells. Well, no, if you leave like a little scrap of your skin or your toenails or your hair is pulled out by the root and somebody in a genetic laboratory takes that, they could basically clone you and they own your entire genetic profile. So this sort of takes it puts it into this dramatic context where what happens if like you lost your child and you want to bring him back. So we have one of the heroines of the book decide she wants to clone her young three-year-old who was lost in a swimming pool accident. So there are just dozens of examples of this, of taking what is seems like science fiction, but it's actually within the realm of today's science capability.
And I should say, this is a really great book, and everyone should read it. It's interesting, the timing of my reading it is, I had just recently decided to reread A Brave New World. And it's an interesting juxtaposition of that being like a architected society of where there are elite people down to sort of almost subhuman people that they have created, the they being like the, you know, like Mustafa Mond and in your case, this is really like the one percenters being able to design the alpha and betas that exist in A Brave New World.
That's right. People, when they read Brave New World in high school or college, you don't really realize it was written like what, almost 90 years ago now?
Yeah, I think so.
It was really amazing, you know, and foretold a lot of what's actually coming down the pike. This is not the government mandating anything like you would see in the remake of Brave New World, I guess, was Gattaca, right? So this sort of takes it to the level of what I think is really going to be happening with the private sector. People are going to have like the right to decide for themselves what kind of genetic progeny to leave behind.
And they might be a prodigy.
They might be a prodigy. We don't like to use the term designer babies at Birthrights Unlimited, so there's certain words to avoid, like eugenics, that sort of thing.
Eugenics is a dirty word.
Yeah, but you know, you get the idea of, you know, you should have the control of your own genetic destiny and your child's destiny. So, what do you decide to do with that? So when it goes to the free market for people to decide for themselves, it opens up all kinds of possibilities, some of them pretty horrific.
Now, you released this as an independent publisher.
Yes.
Were you always planning to go that route with this book?
Not necessarily. So I'm going to be talking about that tonight. Last fall, I sent out about 50 different query letters to different agents, just because my last book was traditionally published by John Wiley & Sons. And this one, Darknet. And I was trying to decide, okay, do I want to do that again? Because it was not completely satisfying, losing your intellectual property rights to the book. I still can't reproduce chapters of my own book on my own site, you know, that sort of thing. It's like crazy. So the more I looked into indie publishing, the more it made sense. I'm still getting rejection letters like 6 months later from these agents, and I'm telling them, well, I'm sorry, I'm not interested, the book is already out. So I decided to go the indie publishing route. And I think young authors today who are breaking into the business for the first time, when they consider the pros and cons, more and more of them are going to be going indie. They have control over their creative art. They can decide what kind of cover to put on the book. They can decide on the title of the book. I didn't even like the name of my last book, but I had no choice about it. You get to retain control over like the movie rights, the TV rights, and you also get to keep like 70% of the royalties instead of like 7%. So it just doesn't make sense unless you're like a big name A-list author like Stephen King or Lee Child, who have, you know, teams of attorneys and publicists and can afford to be in every single bookstore in the country. So I'm taking it one step at a time. We're going to see how this goes.
And so this book has a very satisfying conclusion, in my opinion. Is there a follow-on coming soon? I know this is listed as the the Gender Wars book one.
Yes, it is. With everything going in the going on in the country right now, I wanted to write about the war between the sexes, as I used to put it, but I call it the gender wars. So this was more about DNA and the right of women to control their own bodies. There's a lot of really scary stuff in the book about human trafficking, that sort of thing. So book two is going to be more around, it's going to come out of the laboratory and go into more of Silicon Valley and virtual reality and the sort of artificial worlds that we're sort of putting up tomorrow that we've started to take a peek at in Ready Player One. But I think people want more realism in their escapes, and so this is going to be more about Caden up against a real arch nemesis who's even more evil than Waterhouse was. So.
More evil?
Yeah, so watch out.
All right. Well, thanks, JD.
Okay.
The book is Biohack. You should go get it on Amazon. The price is great.